Is this on? Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. Welcome this evening. I want to warmly welcome you, all the family, all the extended family, all the many who have been like family. That goes pretty far and wide. All the friends that are here, those from our congregation, the staff that have worked with Heidi. This evening we gather to remember, to grieve, to celebrate the sweet person and life of Heidi Cobb. To those who knew her, you can thank God for the opportunity to have memories with her that you will have always as gifts from Heidi. They will remain with you always. Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we join here this evening in the name of your Son. And Lord, we thank you that as we do that, your presence is here among us. Father, we come tonight with heavy hearts and also with hearts that do rejoice, knowing that Heidi is with you. She is safe with you. God, we thank you for that. We ask now for your presence here to comfort as we feel the loss and the sorrow, as we feel her absence. And yet, we will celebrate the life of Heidi Charlene Kolb. We thank you for her life and how she touched so many of us. We know that you are our God and Father who gives all good things. And we thank you for the life of Heidi, who has been married to Joel for 28 years, and that we can know also that she's in your presence, seeing your face, face to face, now and for all eternity. God, grace us with your sweet presence also, as we share and we gather tonight to remember and we yet celebrate Heidi and her life. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would like to read three scriptures as we begin this evening. The first scripture is from Psalm 116, verse 5 through 9. Joel, who, it's funny, I always keep wanting to say Pastor Joel because he is one of our pastors on staff here, and we honor him, respect him as that. But it was exactly 1 year in 2016 that Heidi made a post in her journal with this psalm, and I will read it. Let my soul be at rest again, for the Lord has been good to me. He has saved me from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. And so I walk in the Lord's presence as I live here on earth. She is now doing that. She is walking in the Lord's presence, not so much on earth, but one better. She's doing that in heaven. In her last hours that she was with Joel and the children, one of the things that she would say was, trust Jesus. How many of you have probably had a time where she said something to you and encouraged you? She was on her bed in the last hours encouraging her husband, encouraging Annetta and Martin, or Elizabeth and Jonas who were there. And so that's how she was. She was always looking to encourage, even over the last year or so when she was not doing well. When she talked to you, you would feel like you were the most important person around, because she was that way. And so this verse is very fitting from Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. And she has taken that beautiful path right now to heaven. John 14, 1 says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. For there are many rooms or mansions in some translations in my Father's house. If this were not so, I would have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you. And when everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. How fitting for that for Heidi. She lived a full life, but yet too short a life. And yet, in her lifetime, getting to know family and how she impacted family, getting to know friends, and as a member of the staff here, she impacted us in a most amazing, amazing way. And so tonight, it's okay if we grieve. It's okay if we sorrow. And yet, we need to look at the greater picture, that God is faithful in every situation. Everything that he does, it does have a purpose. We don't always understand that purpose at the time. I believe that Heidi's decision to go on this trip, because she had missions in her heart along with Joel. That was their heart's call. And she was determined to make this trip. And it so pleased the Lord. I have no question about it. She knew that she knew that she knew that she was supposed to take this trip. And so what better place to have gone home than to be on the mission field where her heart was. And so I'd like to now ask for the Hopewell worship team, which is up here, to lead us in some songs. I believe the words are going to be some worship songs. I believe they're going to be up on the wall there. But I ask you to join us. The first one is No Longer Slaves, and she is no longer bound, no longer slaves. The second one is Sovereign Over Us by Michael W. Smith. And the third one is My Jesus, I Love Thee. If you're able to stand, would you stand with us as we worship our Lord now?
No longer a slave to fear. split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child.
There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. And you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. You are working in our waiting. You're sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust that your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You are wisdom unimagined. Who could understand your ways? Reigning high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly, compassionate and kind. You surround and you uphold me, and your promises are my delight. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten. us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. What the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good, for your glory. And even in the valley, you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good and for your glory. Even what the enemy means for evil, turn it for our good. You turn it for our good and for your glory. And even in the valley, you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good and for your glory. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire. Blood. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Let's sing that one more time. You're faithful forever. You're perfect in love. You are sovereign over us.
Purchased my thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee in life, and I will love thee in death.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. Heidi is one who knew she belonged to Jesus. She loved Jesus. She was in a special place with him over the last year or so in the most amazing way as we walked together with her. I want to mention something Pastor Joel is going to be coming here in a moment to share about Heidi's life. I want to mention this, though, for those who didn't have a chance to visit with the family. You will have a chance at the end of the service. And I believe those that are seated in this area here, you'll be able to come up and visit with them. So if you're over on this side, you need to find your way to that side by the time that we get to the end this evening. But you will have time at the end to share with them. I want to invite Joel to come up now.
Wow. Wow. I want to tell you a little bit of Heidi's story. For those of you who are on the internet, you may have seen I posted on her blog a couple of days ago. What I'm going to share now is essentially that, with a little bit more beside. Heidi and I, since our early married years, have made a habit of regularly just getting away. We'd look for a park, a place away from the noise, just a place to be together. I remember one of our conversations on one such occasion. One of the places that Heidi and I liked to go was Lancaster County. We had a couple of favorite B&Bs out there. But the thing is that we were not really interested in the usual tourist attractions. We found a local park away from the tourists, away from all of the noise. There was a stream ran along the edge of the park, an abundance of various plants and trees. And I remember sitting by that stream and watching the squirrels play as we were enjoying each other's company. I think I'm going to write a blog, she announced to me. I was a bit taken back. Heidi was not usually one to express herself in words, except to a few people. What would you write? I said. I would just post pictures of things that make me smile. Well, that didn't make sense to me at first. But then, of course, those of you who know Heidi and I know that we are two very different people. Heidi and I met in high school. It was the first week of school, my freshman year. I was sitting beside my best friend, and two tables across from us, she was sitting with her best friend. And they were giggling and pointing and giggling and pointing. And they were two juniors who thought that the new freshman looked so adorable. And I was drawn to her smile. I remember how she and a friend would suddenly come skipping down the sidewalk, and each one would grab one of my arms, and they would try to make me skip along with them. I don't know how many of you knew me back then. I was a little uptight. And so, so serious in those days. But I loved her exuberance. And it drew something out of me that I didn't know was there. Later that year, we were both involved in a student-led Bible study. The leaders of the Bible study were seniors, and they asked me to lead the Bible study after they graduated. So I poured myself into it, preparing my thoughts, lecturing the group with my insights every Tuesday morning. They didn't know how to tell me, but what I was doing was really tearing that group apart. So they delegated Heidi to come and talk to me. Because, they said to her, you're the only one he listens to. It seemed that she did most of the listening. We spent countless hours, lunch hours, by the pond there at Christopher Dock on that beautiful campus, me expounding on theology, philosophy, the meaning of life, and her apparently somehow drawn to my words. And then there came a time, I don't remember exactly when, I don't remember if it was while we were dating or I think it was more likely some years after we were married. During one of those conversations, it suddenly occurred to me that she probably had some interesting thoughts as well. So I asked her, "What are you thinking?" "Nothing." "Okay, how can it be nothing?" I said, because you know me, my mind is always busy. "Oh, I was just enjoying the song of the birds. And there's a butterfly over there. And, well, I'm just enjoying being here and being with you." "Teach me how to do that." That was my exact words to her. "Teach me how to do that." Over these 28 years, she has taught me. She's taught me how to enjoy life. She slows me down, and she points out things that are all around me, so full of beauty and meaning, which I would otherwise miss. You know, there was a time when Annetta was just a baby, and we were living in Denmark. We would teach Annetta what sound different animals make, sometimes both in English and in Danish. They're different, you know. And we would tell her, we would say, "The bird says, tweet, tweet. The cow goes, moo." And Annetta would repeat those little phrases after us. But there was one day, I remember it so well. We were in a remote part of North Jutland and waiting for a train at a train platform that was just out in the middle of a field. And the birds are singing. And Annetta, who's maybe about a year old at this point, is listening to the birds, and it suddenly occurs to her, "The bird says, tweet, tweet." And in her sweet little voice, she starts saying, "Tweet, tweet, tweet." And that taught me something. Now, it's one thing to know the sound that the birds make. It's another thing to actually hear the sound of the birds. That's what Heidi taught me. And eventually, it took many years of marriage, I eventually learned that I could perceive what she was thinking if I would just slow myself down enough to listen. I learned to perceive her thoughts. I learned to make observations. I learned how to transcend words. I always joke that Heidi came from a family of mind readers. Often said that about the Miller family. The Miller family is a family of mind readers. They don't talk, they just know what each other's thinking. Us Cobbs, on the other hand, we talk about everything. We talk about things you're not supposed to talk about. She and her brother Steve shared a connection where she would often start or even complete a task before he even asked her to do it. She also shared her father's strong intuitive sense. I would listen to them as they would have whole fragmented conversations, nodding and finishing each other's sentences. It took me many years of being married to her, but I eventually learned to trust her perceptions, to listen to my own inner thoughts and feelings. I would also sometimes help her put her thoughts into words. When she began her blog, I used to suggest edits to her work. But after a while, most of her posts were published without my help. When Heidi was diagnosed with cancer, the blog took on a new sense of purpose. It wasn't just about noticing the pleasant things in life, but about recognizing the truly important things in life while facing death. Heidi chose to focus on life and on healing, knowing full well that healing can come in different ways. She trusted God with the future, knowing that because God is good, His plans for her are good. Heidi very much disliked death. She didn't like to think about it. She didn't like the emotions that go with it, and she certainly didn't like the imagery of death. Two things that Heidi had told me years ago about when she dies. This was before illness was even in the picture. She told me, one, she didn't want a viewing. She didn't like viewings. Couldn't understand why anybody would want one. The second thing she told me is that she didn't want anyone to see her dying. She didn't want a bunch of people around her as she was dying. She was with her grandfather the night that he passed away, and she didn't want anyone else to have to experience that. Well, she got her wish. She passed away in a hospital in Tokyo, Japan. We were on our way to Thailand with our two youngest children to visit missionaries. Her health was declining, especially in the last weeks. We had already been told that we were out of options as far as conventional medicine was concerned. Her response was to continue with life, with the tasks and the call that God had for her life. She believed that she would be healed. And we couldn't think of any better way to pursue healing than to just walk in obedience to God. Simply do what He told us to do. If we stopped to wait for healing, death would surely overtake her. The first leg of the journey was already too much. We decided to hold in Japan and get medical help. I said to Heidi, I said, well, maybe if we just got a hotel for the night and you got some rest, maybe we could decide in the morning whether to continue or whether to go back. But at moments or an hour or so, she had already determined she needed a doctor, needed one now. She was only in the hospital one night. The children and I were put up in a hotel. The phone rang in the middle of the night. The front desk informed me in broken Japanese and English that my wife was asking to see me and that they had already ordered a taxi. I was to go to the hospital right away. Jonas and Elizabeth, I offered them to go with me, but they were ready to sleep. We had been about 30 hours and maybe 2 hours asleep. During the 20-minute ride to the hospital, I wondered, is she telling me that she's dying? Or is she maybe miraculously recovered and ready to go home? So I walked into Heidi's room. I found her sitting up in bed, smiling sweetly. Her face had become thin over the past number of weeks. Some of you noticed that. But her face was full and radiant. She told me that she was having difficulty getting comfortable and that she was not able to communicate her needs to the staff who only spoke Japanese. So she had me call in the staff and lower her bed about 2 inches. And I said, "Is that what you called me here for? 20 minutes and a $40 taxi ride to lower your bed 2 inches?" "No," she said, there was another reason. I can't remember right now." So the staff offered me a metal chair and was just kind of like, sit, please, sit. So I sat and we talked. What a gift that time was. I was there for about an hour talking. We talked about the decision to go to Thailand. "Why did you let me talk you out of coming?" I said to her. She had no regrets. She said, "We are only being obedient to the call of God on our lives by doing what God has given us to do." I said to her, I said, "Heidi, you realize if something happens to you here, what am I going to do? How am I going to get you back home again?" She said, "You'll know what to do. Do what you need to do. Just trust Jesus." So many questions I had. They were all answered in those moments. She said that over and over again. Trust Jesus. She said it in the airport. She said it in the emergency room. When our children had the opportunity to see her, she told them, "Trust Jesus. Just trust Jesus." Before I left to go back to the hotel, those were her last words. Heidi made quite an impression in a short amount of time. Everywhere we went in the hospital, we would hear people whispering in Japanese, but I would recognize one word, her name, Heidi. The hospital administrator, Mr. Hasegawa, made his staff available to me to help figure out the paperwork and the process of getting her remains back home. When he came to the hospital after she had passed, I was out in the hallway. I was talking with his staff about the next steps, and he took me by the arm and he marched me straight to her room, and he stood by my side and wept with me. When we left that hospital, we were hugging and crying with the staff like we had been friends. See, I'm a person of many words, but Heidi was a person of a few words. But her few words said more than my many. Trust Jesus. Trust Jesus. Do we need to say any more than that? The most beautiful things in life are simple. And the most profound truth is plain. When we arrived the next morning, we arrived just in time to witness her last breaths. She was already unconscious. Her breathing was intermittent. And I told the children as we walked into the room, as a pastor, I've been through this before with many other people, but it's different when it's your wife. I told them, I said, "This is what it looks like at the end." We prayed. We sang. We prayed some more. Her breaths kept getting further and farther apart. There were times where I thought she had passed. I wasn't quite sure. And then there would come another breath. And eventually there came just from within me this deep groan, and I felt like something was being ripped out of my chest. And I knew that her spirit had left and it had taken a piece of me with it. When I last saw her face, Heidi was smiling. She had just a faint grin across her face. Heidi wouldn't want you to know this, but I do have pictures. If you need to see them, see me. There was a faint grin across her face, and Jonas and Elizabeth spent about 2 or 3 hours in that room with her body while I was doing paperwork. They handled themselves very well. Elizabeth was working on puzzles and Jonas was playing on his phone and teasing his sister. One point they were joking and laughing and Elizabeth looked over and she said, "It looks like Mom's laughing." The smile was getting wider and wider across her face. So the last time I saw her face, she was smiling. And she was enjoying beauty beyond words. The next thing that we're going to do is have for you a slideshow and a very special song. I was grateful for a local Denny's, a little piece of America there, that had free Wi-Fi where I could get the message out to friends and family. I posted on Facebook once I knew that the children knew. When I got back to the hotel, there was already an email there from an old friend. Eugene Greco was our worship leader at Christ for the Nations, where Heidi and I went to Bible school in Long Island. Heidi and I sang with Eugene. We were a couple of his backup singers there as students. We recorded the Hosanna album, number 31, Exalt the Lord. We recorded that at Christ for the Nations with Eugene. Eugene and his wife, Joy, are currently serving as missionaries in Spain. And he sent me a song that he had written while he was serving as the worship pastor at Bible Temple Church. One of their colleagues, one of their pastor's wives, had passed away, and he wrote this song for that occasion, but he wanted to share it with us. So I asked him if it would be okay if we would share it publicly. And then my son Martin and our kids, we went through old photos and put some pictures to it. So please enjoy this. Enjoy these memories with us.
Come to the place prepared for you. Your days of pain and grief are through. Enter my joy, so free, so full. I have prepared a place for you in every test. You've stayed so true. Prepared for you. come to the place prepared for you. No weapons assail, no tongues accuse, nothing to fear, a sweet refuge. I have prepared a place for you. For you.
Hopefully you'll find enough boxes of tissues around. What can one say? That is so beautiful. So beautiful. There are a couple just thoughts I want to share. And then there's a special song by Preston and the family. Heidi was a wonderful employee here. But more than that, she was a friend. She was like, and we were like family, and still are. And so I experienced on many occasions, that mind reading part that Joel mentioned. And I would come to Heidi and I say, Heidi, I need, and she not only finished the sentence, but she had the report done. And early on, I didn't know this, Joel had to explain to me that she had this ability to do that and know things that well in advance. We got the pleasure to take a trip to Washington, D.C. with Joel and Heidi just a few weeks before on July 16th. And she was working hard to stay right up with us. And I believe it was Anita that talked with her and said, Heidi, are you sure you want to go? She said right back, she said, if I can't make it to Washington, how am I going to make it to Thailand? Always looking ahead. Always having an amazing viewpoint. I want to share this from Dolores, our secretary, because I think it's just so amazing and so profound, these key thoughts, and they're for all of us. Dolores wrote this, remembering Heidi today and some things that she taught us in the last year. She taught us how to live with a terminal illness, to laugh and enjoy each day, to not let illness have the greater portion. She taught us to trust that Jesus is good. Even when our eyes do not see the evidence of what we think is good. She taught us that even though we walk through the shadow of death, to not fear evil. She taught us to let our light shine to those around us, to speak out the power of Jesus, to heal, even to the doctors. She taught us courage. She taught us to continue to bless others in the midst of pain and suffering. She taught us the importance of relationships and living in peace with one another. She taught us that the Lord is a good shepherd. He leads us in paths of righteousness. He restores our souls. He leads us beside the still waters. She tapped into that peace of God. She taught us to rejoice when others in their joy and to not feel sorrow for what she was experiencing. And she taught us to lean into the everlasting arms. She trusted Jesus to the very end. She taught us not to be afraid of death. I would like to invite Preston to come up and family members that will be sharing this song.
I am Preston, an older brother of Heidi. Back around February of this year, I was surprised by an invitation by Heidi to come over and sing with her. We set a time on a Tuesday afternoon, and we spent about an hour singing hymns of our faith together. At one point, I asked her, why is it that you asked me to come, but nobody else? And she said, well, when I was young, you used to sing with me. And I wanted to do it again. I never remembered that until she told me, and even now it's kind of a fuzzy memory. But knowing that I do like to sing, I'm sure that it did happen, and it'll be a memory that I cherish the rest of my life. My daughter Amanda and son Sam and granddaughter Trinity will also be singing with us, with me.
I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. Talks with me and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him
more. It's a different, there we go. Thank you, Preston. Thank you, family, for sharing those memories of that singing together. We're going to have a sharing time in just a few moments, and the family will be coming, number of members of the family will be coming up to share. And then we will have some time for some of the gathering here, but certainly we could go on all evening, so we'll have to limit that. But I have a special recognition that I want to give at this time before we go into that. If I could ask Joel and Annetta, Martin, Jonas, and Elizabeth to come up here. Heidi, for many, many years, she started out keeping our accounting, our books. She started just doing so many, many things in the administrative area, and just made things really flow. I thought at times she was the oil that made the gears move and accomplish a lot. And then when she became ill, we began to see just something very, very, very special coming out of her life as she began to minister to people even while she was yet going through her own difficulties. And we began to see a pastoral quality coming out in Heidi's life. And we as elders began to recognize that. And so we want to dedicate and give this award that we had actually approved and before Heidi passed away, and we were not able to give it. But we are giving today a pastoral license to Heidi as administrative pastor.
I just want you to know Heidi knew about this.
It says, Hopewell Christian Fellowship, pastoral license. This certifies that Heidi Kalb has been licensed as a minister of the gospel through Hopewell Christian Fellowship, Telford, and is authorized to serve as a minister and is afforded all the rights, privileges, and honors thereof. Her ministry assignment was administrative pastor. And we put down a beginning date of July 26th when we concluded it, but we put down no ending date. So I want to give this to all of you on behalf of your mom, on behalf of your wife. And we just thank the Lord for her and for all of you. Can we give a hand to them and bless them? Amen.
Heidi knew about this. It was something that early on in our ministry, Heidi said, basically, I want to take every step that you take. I want to always be your equal in ministry. Of course, raising children makes it hard to do that. But it was difficult for Heidi sometimes because she had difficulty putting things into words sometimes that I did, but one of the things that having cancer did is it drew something out of her that now she had nothing to lose. So she began to venture out and speak out in ways that she might not have otherwise. And so, you know, we were anticipating continuing for many years, but this was not expected to be given in this way, but I just want to thank the leadership of Hopewell Christian Fellowship for recognizing that gift and affirming it.
Amen. Amen. I want to ask now for family members that are prepared to share to come on up. I don't know what order you'd like to do that, but please come on up and feel free to share. You can all come up at the same time, even.
So I'm Steve. Heidi was my younger sister. As a young boy in the first grade, I can remember the thrill of learning that I had a new baby sister in the family. I can remember running home from the bus stop and sprinting across the lawn to get in the house to see my little sister for the first time. I'm not sure how long that excitement lasted. As any younger sibling would do, she started trying to keep up with me and getting into my stuff. This may have caused a little friction between us at a young age. But as we matured, our relationship grew. Now, growing up in a family business allows you to get really good at working together for a common goal. For years, Heidi was our administrative assistant, office manager, but she was more than that. She was good at organizing business outings like summer picnics and Christmas dinners. I think that she would make people feel welcome and at ease. She was approachable. I think this was one of Heidi's best qualities. Sometimes siblings will communicate without saying a word, as you've heard. You just know what the other's thinking, and Heidi and I had that. When Heidi and Joel, Elizabeth, and Jonas were going to the airport, I had the privilege of taking them. I dropped them off and gave them hugs. I was hugging Heidi when our eyes met. There was something she was trying to say through her eyes. At that moment, I did not understand. But now as I look back, I believe she was saying, just trust God. I love you. Goodbye for now. Someday, I will run across the green grass in heaven and get to see Heidi forever. Heidi, I love you.
We have some others here that are ready to come up. Or I can come down there too. This is Eleanor, Heidi's mom.
Heidi loved her family, animals, and singing. She loved God and was true to her faith. She was a very happy child and loved parties. She always I can't even see what it is. What is that word? She always wanted her birthday to have birthday parties. People being much younger.
It's better up close.
Okay. She always wanted parties, despite being the younger than her siblings. The rest of the family didn't mind her celebrating. They really loved her. She loved being with people and celebrating life with others. My parents used to come up from Florida in the summer and stay in the apartment attached to the house. Heidi was very fond of Mom and Pop and developed a special bond with them. She loved spending time with them and shared a special love. As I was sitting at home reading from Revelation 22 last Saturday, I saw Heidi dancing. She danced right up to Mom and Pop. This brought joy to my heart. That God would share this with me. And I rejoice in knowing that Jesus made the way for family to enjoy each other again one day.
Others that are here, family members.
Hi, I am Heidi's niece. My mom, Linda, is her older sister. Okay. I cried out of shock when my mom told me Heidi passed away. I didn't want to believe it to be true, but I knew there was a 0% chance my mom was lying. I loved my aunt, and I initially didn't know how to process her death, what to think, or what to say, so I avoided it. I dove into all sorts of tasks to keep myself busy, to keep going. It wasn't until this past Monday that I began to address her passing, and more importantly, why I loved and admired her so much. Heidi had an undeniable zest for life and love for people. I thought about how her smile would light up a room and her presence would bring comfort to those around her. But it was Heidi's positivity and optimism that always stood out and connected me to her. She was a glass half full kind of gal. When she was first diagnosed with cancer, I worried that it would wear on her positive attitude and chip away at her optimist outlook. So I looked for a gift that would remind her to hold on to hope and to keep a positive mental attitude throughout the healing process. It was only fitting when I found a drawing of half-full water glasses with the words, "Hope is essential." Sure enough, Heidi never lost hope or optimism. She never let the cancer define her or dictate her ability to create purpose and meaning in life. She lived her life until the very end as the Heidi that we all love and know. It is now our turn to heal from our loss. We need to continue to live our lives and keep focused on what gives us meaning, just like Heidi did. Heidi wrote a blog post about the Hope is Essential drawing, and I think she said it best, and I took this from Heidi's blog. "We all need hope. Hope is the basis of faith. In the book of Hebrews, it says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Sometimes faith," and Heidi goes on to say, "sometimes faith and hope are things that help us get from one day to the next." And I think that is what we are going to be doing. Thank you.
Someone else? Okay.
I'm Sam. I'm Heidi's Joel and Heidi's nephew. Fearless, committed, faithful. When it came to Aunt Heidi, there were a lot of different ways you could describe her, but these are three that stood out to me. For me, she was more than an aunt. She was my friend. Somebody you could always count on to pray for you if you asked for it. Somebody that would make you feel like the most important person in the world when you talked to her. And somebody whose faith spoke louder than words could ever say. This past Easter, I had the privilege of getting to spend time with Aunt Heidi as part of the music drama Portrait of Love here at the church, and it was a blessing to share that time with her. I remember, even with everything she had been through in this past year, she still put everything she had into that drama. Yeah, Heidi played an angel, and she had her flag wings, and was so graceful and beautiful as she praised God through the drama, and now she's probably the prettiest angel up there, and she's still waving her flags. And one of the things that I'll always remember is her smile and her laugh. One memory that I've been thinking about a lot this week is about a year ago, Melissa and I went to Aunt Heidi and Uncle Joel's for a game night with some of the other young adults in our church. And we were all playing apples to apples, and it was Aunt Heidi's turn to pick the winner of the round. As we all put our cards in to describe the word that was chosen, Uncle Joel had one of the wild cards where he would choose his own word to describe the word. And he chose the word, "our love," and put his hand on Aunt Heidi's and looked in her eyes, and she giggled and blushed and, of course, picked his card. And, of course, he did that three more times, and, of course, she picked him as the winner each time. Their love and marriage was and will always be an inspiration to Melissa and I. We had the privilege of both Aunt Heidi and Uncle Joel having such a huge role in our marriage, and forever I will be thankful for that. I miss and love her so much, but I know that one day I'll see her again.
Promise it's not the whole book. I only had the privilege of knowing Aunt Heidi for 3 years, and though it was too short of a time with her, the memories I have will forever be beautiful and precious to me. She constantly encouraged, and she listened with enthusiasm at every crazy new idea I had as I was struggling to find my purpose in life. Even though I was part of the family only by marriage, she always made me feel as though she had known me my whole life, and she was my friend and my family. I struggled this week coming up with the right words to say, but as I watched my daughter toddle around the house, the words came to me. My most precious memories that I have of Aunt Heidi are those that she shared with my daughter, Lorelai. Lorelai and Aunt Heidi shared a special bond. From the very first moment that Aunt Heidi met her, I watched her fall in love with that little girl. And every Sunday, I watched Aunt Heidi and Uncle Joel playfully fight over who got to hold her during the service. She was the first person who could get Lorelai to fall asleep in her arms, even over me. And the first time that Lorelai walked assisted, you know, like as if like with my fingers, was across the room here. And she walked from that corner all the way to that corner the very first time because she saw Aunt Heidi across the church. She made a beeline for her and she just gave her a hug, which as many of you know, is a very rare occurrence for that little busy bee. But every time she saw Aunt Heidi, she had a long hug for her. And it breaks my heart that she will not get to see Lorelai grow up, but Lorelai will never not know her because we will continually share these precious memories with her. I loved her so much and I'm grateful for the time that I'd got with her.
Someone else from the family? Is there anyone else that would like to share? Someone else? Yeah. Okay, I'd like to ask for maybe five people to come, Margaret, from the congregation or friends. We'll have time for about five. Margaret is one who has been like a family member there. With the children. So.
During the service this morning, the Lord reminded me of, this is what he had said to me this morning at the service. The Lord is showed me as Heidi as a seed planted in Tokyo. At the hospital administrator had compassion and ministered to Joel's needs, and he was very touched by the family and also was grieving with them. Mr. Hashigami assisted Joel and the family to with all their the things that they had to take care of at Heidi's passing. And Joel was as Joel returned to the hospital afterwards, he was prompted by the Holy Spirit to give him Mr. Hashigami the believer's baptism, which Joel had written. And he was at first Joel was hesitant because he was a Buddhist. And then Mr. Hashigami said, on behalf of the Red Cross Hospital, I accept this book. And I feel that somehow God is going to use this to minister and as a mission to open to the Lord for in Tokyo.
Lord. Couple of others real quickly. Any others that want to share? Okay, come on. And if any other, maybe two more, if you want to share, come on up a while. We just want to give you an opportunity.
Hi, my name is Richard Hayes. For over half my life, I knew the family, Joel, Heidi, and their kids. And I was best friends, particularly with Martin, their eldest son. And Heidi, whenever I came over, which was many, many, many times, loved me. I used to call her surrogate mom because she treated me as one of her own. But I think one of the things that defines a person as a parent is their kids. And I find daily inspiration in their kids. I find daily faith and daily renewal watching my best friend, Martin, in his daily walk with the Lord. I see him, and when I heard of Heidi's passing, I stopped. I stopped everything. I couldn't move. I just had to stop because I loved Mrs. Cole very much. And I saw their kids. And they kept going. Now, I have aspirations in the military, and one of the things we're supposed to do very well is keep going. And they surpassed that. They showed me a new level of faith in the Lord, and when I heard the theme of trust Jesus, it explained everything to me. How much she had instilled in her children the love of God. And it opened my eyes again. And I've had my struggles with my walk in the Lord, as we all have, but watching them deal with their mother's death, something that I don't know how I would cope with, in such a very loving and caring and steadfast way, proved to me that Heidi was one of the best parents I've ever seen and one of the best friends that I could ever know. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Heather. I'm a member of the congregation here, but I'm also a cousin of Heidi. And a few months ago, I sent her this devotional from Worship Means Everything by Darlene Check. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, I'm just going to read part of it. But Darlene, if you know her as a worship artist from Hillsong, she had breast cancer and she survived. But this is an excerpt. She said, "As I entered the medical treatments, there were many moments of discouragement, frustration, and despair. I could hardly think straight. During chemo, I think my emotions shut down for a while. I just felt numb. But as I learned to open myself, my heart again to God's presence and just simply be with Him, worship began to flow, slowly but wholeheartedly. And His presence with me in those dark days is something I treasure more than words can express. And I know this ministered to Heidi deeply too. She told me, she said, God spoke to her in that numbness and in that pain, not with audible words, but so clearly in her spirit. Heidi, do you trust me? She weighed her heart and her answer carefully, and her answer was soft, but she was tired, and she didn't feel energy coursing through her body, but her answer was, yes, God, I trust you. That God came so close to talk to her was enough for me, to be, as her friend, to know that I could keep encouraging her, but it wasn't enough for God. He wasn't done talking to her. His next question, which went straight to her heart and soul, overwhelmed me when she told me this. He asked, Heidi, do you know how much I really love you? Tears coursed down her cheeks. She's a church girl. We're church people. We know God loves us. We know the Bible verses and the right answers. We know that God loved us so much He gave us Son to die for us. But God doesn't want us to answer with what we grew up with and the answers we knew in our head. He wants to know, and her to know at that moment, how much He loved her right then and how much He loves us right now deep in our hearts. To be honest, she was struggling with this question and I didn't know it until she told me after she read the devotional. And in that moment, she said she gave God her answer. Yes, I know how much you love me. And she did, and she still does. And because she loved Him, she trusted Him with the process. His presence, His love, and Joel and the kids overwhelmed all of us, and God's love overwhelms us. It hurt God and us that they are walking through suffering. I'm still awed at Heidi's faith And I hear Psalm 23 loud and clear within me. Though she walked through the valley of the shadow of death, she walked through and she walked to the other side. Was she tired? Did she feel pain? She did. But in that precious moment of worship, her love and God's love washed over and over her and over me, and I pray it will wash over you as well. And I believe, and she believed, in that experience that she was able to say with Job, though he slayed me, yet I trusted him.
Thank you for that. Amen. Heidi was a worshiper, and to the maximum, I would say, and she loved to worship in flags and in dance. And so there is a very special song that she said, when I get my healing, she said, I'm going to play this. And so there is a song that's going to be a special song right now called Shouting Grounds by David Crowder, and our worship team and our flag and dance team will be participating in honor of Heidi, because she loved to do this so much. So I want to invite Pamela, I think, to come. And the team to come up.
The next song is called Shouting Grounds by David Crowder, and it's not the kind of song you usually hear at a funeral. We decided to close on a note of celebration. Joel wrote this. Heidi enjoyed expressing herself with flags and dance. She would have wanted celebration at her funeral. Heidi said that when she received her healing, she wanted to post this song on her blog. After she passed, I, Joel, remembered the song and decided to post it on her Facebook. The words, "I should be dead right now, but I am alive," were meaningful to her because she had almost died last summer shortly after diagnosis. To her, it was a metaphor of escaping death. But now in these circumstances, it is a reminder that death has passed for her. It is rejoicing in the hope of resurrection.
Still a song to sing, fall down on your knees and cry aloud. On my grave, shouting grounds, a prodigal lost was found. I should be dead right now, but I am alive. I just wanna see your face. You're calling me from my grave. Take me to the shouting grounds. It's gonna get loud.
Well, how many know that Heidi is shouting right now there with a Jesus? Amen. That so expresses her and her heart to be able to shout before the Lord, and in his presence, she is able to do that right now. Would you stand with me as we just close this evening? But we're not closing, we're not ending. We're taking these memories tonight with us. We're taking Heidi with us in our hearts. We're praying for Joel and the family to continue to live in the light of the memories that they have, and that God will continue to strengthen them and continue to pour out blessing. I believe there will be many things that were coming that are so good that through the children, the life of Heidi is going to be lived out too. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we rejoice right now, even in these moments, when we do feel even some sadness. Lord, we thank you that you are here, the God of all comfort. And Lord, I pray now that you will help each one of us to keep those memories alive in our hearts and our mind. God, I pray that you will continue to surround the family, Joel and all of the children, Lord. Surround them with your love. Surround them with your protection. Surround them with your covering, O God. Surround them with your comfort. And that, Lord, that you would do a work that is beyond what we can even imagine, Lord. Because we stand in a moment in time, but God, you are eternal. And so, Lord, we look forward to you and for how you will move in the family's life. And, Lord, in all of our lives who have known Heidi. So, Lord, help us to carry the gift of the memory of Heidi with us now. And we thank you that she is there safe with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 You can be seated for a moment, or if you need to leave, if you visited with the family, you may be dismissed. But I'm going to turn it over then to Mr. Anders here from the funeral home. He'll give some direction.
As people were entering, we sat them in line on my left, your right. So we're going to dismiss those first. They were actually standing in line, but we sat them down. And if there's anybody else that would like to meet with the family, make your way slowly around to your right. But we're going to dismiss that whole section. The left-hand section is all waiting to go through the line. And the rest that have met with the family, you may consider yourselves dismissed.